गुड इवनिंग समस्तंको नमस्कार इस टू हैव ऑल ऑफ यू वंस अगेन आमे इवनिंग सेशन ने मु समस्तंको ओडिशा डेवलपमेंट इनिशिएटिव तरफ रु स्वागत जणउची आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ओडिशा डेवलपमेंट इनिशिएटिव्स एंड ऑल द सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड डेवलपमेंट प्रोफेशनल्स कम टुगेदर फॉर द ओडिशा डेवलपमेंट कॉन्क्लेव दिस इज द एंड सेशन ऑफ द डे We inaugurated Odisha Development Conclave 2020 this morning, and we had a number of sessions in the morning. A plenary session in the morning where we released the report of the development, the Odisha Development Report, and also we deliberated on some of the issues. Because of the pandemic, we are limited and not able to do the kind of program that we have been doing for last two editions, where more than 18 or 19 tracks get discussed. But nevertheless, we managed to come together on this wonderful web space. And I take this opportunity to welcome guests of this evening. It's my honor and privilege to introduce to all of you Justice Anand Kumar Patnaik. Justice Patnaik is an eminent jurist of our time. He was the Chief Justice of the High Court of Chhattisgarh and later became the Chief Justice of the High Court of Madhya Pradesh. He was appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of India, also served as the Executive Chairman of the Odisha State Legal Service Authority. Presently, Justice Anand Kumar Patnaik is the Chairman of Umbadsi Oversight Authority, Odisha Mineral Areas Development Corporation. Welcome, Justice Patnaik. It's my privilege to welcome you. We have Dr. Bhagwan Prakash. All of you know him. Dr. Bhagwan Prakash is a renowned personality with three decades of experience, more than that, on human development and civil society issues. He has worked as a senior advisor at Election Commission of India, an advisor to Government of India on Youth Affairs, founder of Odisha Nagarik Samaj, and many more feathers in his cap. Bhagwan Prakash to this evening session. We have with us Dr. Rajesh Tandon. Dr. Rajesh Tandon is an internationally acclaimed leader and practitioner of participatory research and development. He's founder president of participatory research in Asia, PRIA, Global Center for Participatory Research and Training since 1982. He's also co-chair of the UNESCO Chair on Community-Based Research and Social Responsibility in Higher Education since 2012. Dr. Tandon also heads the Forum for Indian Development Cooperation, FIDC, as its chairperson. FIDC is a tripartite initiative of the Development Partnership Administration of the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, Academia, and Civil Society Organization. Dr. Tandon has served on numerous expert committees of Government of India, UGC, UN, Commonwealth, and World Bank. He is also the current chairperson of CYSD. Welcome you, Dr. Tandon. It is such a pleasure to always welcome you here. Yes, physically, we are not there, but then web space is there to, you know, like kind of bridge that gap. So, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, we have our guests for this evening. Before I start the evening program, I think all of you must have, you know, seen this short video that my colleagues were playing about the Odisha Development Conclave that we have been actually doing for last 4-5 years. Every 2 years, we do this conclave for the guests, those who are new to this conclave. This is my responsibility to a little bit, you know, talk about the Odisha Development Conclave. We also have Jagdananji with us here. And the member secretary and advisor of CYSD. We also have Mr. Prafulla Kumar Sahu, who was the former chairman of CYSD and a co-founder of CYSD, a silent but very significant contributor to the process of development. So welcome you, Mr. Sahu. I would like to invite Dr. Tandon. Dr. Tandon, you have been part of this Odisha Development Conclave from the very beginning, and it's always a privilege to welcome you. And with this August gathering, and in this particular time when the pandemic is actually, you know, causing a lot of problems to all of us, it has, you know, like impacts. innumerable impacts on people. Also, the civil society is a very challenging time for all the civil societies here. Those have been working on this issue with their courage, with their passion. I just would like to request you, sir, how do you see the role of a civil society organization in the development process in this pandemic time and also in general? So if you just could throw some light on this aspect. Over to you, Dr. Tandon.
Thank you very much, Sneha, and wonderful to have this opportunity to be able to participate, though virtually. I vividly recall being physically actively participating in the first and the second conclaves held in 2016 and 2018. And I do hope that in the coming year, we will have another opportunity. The report released this morning on the Odisha's development priorities under the able guidance of Professor Kundu, built on the work that was done in 2018 Odisha Development Conclave. But the year 2020, which is about to come to an end, actually has impacted those priorities and our world, our everyday world, and those of our communities and our fellow citizens around the world, in particular in India, and certainly in Odisha. I was so impressed with the three themes that were selected for conversation this morning in the parallel session. And I want to return to those themes, why they are exceptionally relevant to post-pandemic reconstruction of not just Odisha, but India and the world. The first theme of moving to scale up organic farming. The natural resource base and the indigenous expertise of our farmers, our tribals in Odisha is such that it should focus on building ecologically sustainable and locally usable agriculture allied products, be they dairy, be they veterinary, be they forestry, be they fishery. The expertise that exists in Odisha's farmers in its rural and agricultural communities mercifully has not been totally surrendered to the chemical-based agriculture that western part of India has experienced in Punjab, Haryana, western Uttar Pradesh. They have destroyed their water base and their land, and the products that they are producing are so chemicalized that right from the process of production to its consumption to all of us as consumers, it has been only causing disease and ill health. The pandemic demonstrated the significance of nurturing local natural base in such a way that it becomes sustainable. If there was one opportunity that Odisha's agriculture and allied rural economy could be re-energized and redirected, it is this of making organic, sustainable, local produced, local consumed agricultural economy, which includes forestry, dairy, fishery, a variety of other related rural produce and rural economy. The second theme that was picked up from distress migration to safe migration, equally important. Our citizens of Odisha have faced severe problems of migration during the pandemic, and you have discussed that. If we work on the first theme, as I have just understood and described, it should substantially reduce, substantially in my view, substantially reduce the need for distress migration. Migration of highly skilled people is one thing, but Odisha is also a place of reverse migration. It has now become a center of technology. Many premier technology companies have opened their major technical sites and production units and software units in Odisha. And a large number of academic and research institutions have come into Odisha. So in that sense, the migration of talented people from Odisha should be limited to opportunities which are contributing to national development or international development. But bulk of the people who run away from the rural and small town areas of Odisha to Mumbai or Surat or Tirupur or Delhi, that should be preventable, and that should be made linked to revival of organic, ecologically sustainable agriculture. The third theme that was picked up on impact of COVID on women and girls, I want to link that theme to the question of education and why access to education has become particularly disturbing during and after the COVID. All conversations that are taking place seem to suggest that primary education is going to be determined and continued through such elite digital platforms like Baiju. Baijus of this world are going to capture the education. But that is not the spirit of national education policy. National education policy requires investment in the education and learning of all, in particular, girls and women. And that policy can only be implemented if public investment is made. And it is not, public investment is not abandoned hoping that private investment will come. Private investment will only come in Baiju. It will not come in building the capacities of our indigenous people, our tribals, our women and girls in those remote areas. So if this is the agenda that we have deliberated today, what is the role of civil society? I feel that Odisha is blessed. I have traveled around the country so many times. I feel Odisha is blessed for it has a very vibrant, very active, and very capable civil society organizations throughout the length and breadth of the state. It has organizations working with tribal people, organizations working with urban poor, organizations working on the coastal area, and it has civil society organizations which have contributed to and demonstrated resilience and disaster preparedness at local village and panchayat and municipality levels. It is therefore a responsibility of all of us who belong to the civil society of Odisha and elsewhere in the country to take upon ourselves a slightly more emboldened and courageous role in post-pandemic 2021 onwards. I have three suggestions for that role. First and foremost, I think the investment that civil society of Odisha had been making in building local leadership and local capability among tribal youth, among women and girls over these years, its value and functionality was demonstrated during the pandemic, because it was only through local animators, local leaders, local youth that support in those difficult times could be provided to the households and neighborhoods when lockdown happened and employment, food, and livelihood became scarce. This needs to be taken up on a large scale. And I want to therefore argue with you all that do not limit this work only with the rural youth. I would argue that you focus on urban youth also. Do not limit this work to only those who come from scheduled tribe or scheduled caste households, but across the board. Invest in building local leadership among young people, among boys and girls, but also especially focus on girls and women, right from the age of adolescence to teenagers and beyond. The second role that I would like civil society in Odisha to consider is to demand that its secondary and tertiary higher education systems focus on Odisha's development agenda. It is blessed today, in the last 20-25 years, higher education institutions all across the state have come up both in the public and the private sector. A large number of people go through these institutions. But what is taught there? What curriculum is taught there? What research do they do which helps people of Odisha and its development? I think civil society should engage with them, demand that they focus on this work, demand that their technology find solutions for the remotest tribal villages of Odisha, not just for companies in US or Europe, and demand that their research and teaching curriculum learns from the vast body of knowledge that indigenous and local communities of Odisha possess. That knowledge has been known for centuries and millennia, but it is being discarded. The pandemic reminds us to lean on local knowledge far more than it has been possible. And the third and the final suggestion I have is that Odisha is also has become a home to large number of national and multinational private companies. They are wide range of companies. They work on mining, they work on a variety of manufacturing. I think civil society needs to engage directly with the private business by asking them to demonstrate how business is changing to respond to the pandemic and the needs of people of Odisha now. It is no longer possible that businesses in Odisha mine the natural resources, its forests and its minerals, and only service through that mining and manufacturing economies of rest of India or internationally. I know we are an interconnected world. I know that we are a national world of unity, but I think civil society in Odisha has not done so as much as it can, and given its capacity and talent, it should directly start engaging with the business community of Odisha, inviting them to ask questions about how they will contribute. So thank you very much, and I look forward to continuing this conversation in the time ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Tandon. It was always wonderful to, you know, like listen to you. You have really put, you know, like words of wisdom and talking about starting from the farming, you know, that Odisha is actually banking on, and also the how to make this distress migration to safe migration, which is call of the hour. And we have seen the how our migrant, you know, population has actually been affected in this pandemic time, and all of us were quite worried, and all of us were, you know, like trying to do whatever is possible in our own way. But I think the time has come to strategize our own intervention, and also thank you once again to remind us to be, you know, like to engage with government, with the corporate, and also with the, you know, like local bodies, which is very, very, you know, very much required. And you have really rightly talked about the impact of COVID on women and girls with relation to the education, which is quite a worry. And in fact, in the afternoon session, as somebody was, you know, like one of our speakers was talking about the speculation of UNEPA that more than 40% girls are going to be dropped out after the school reopens. And this is the time when we are also talking about, you know, kind of having a robust education system with the support of the National Education Policy. So thank you so much for all those, you know, like deliberations. Ladies and gentlemen, this is my privilege again to introduce Professor Amitabh Kundu, who has been there with us from the morning. Welcome you, sir. Let me just take 1 or 2 minutes to speak about Dr. Kundu. Professor Dr. Amitabh Kundu is currently working as a Distinguished Fellow at the Research and Information System for Developing Countries. He's chairing the committee overviewing the survey of Swachh Bharat Mission, and he was Regional Advisor on Poverty at UNESCO, Beirut during 2017, and consultant to the government during 2016. Until January 2014, he was professor at the JNU, New Delhi, and he has served as a member of National Statistics Commission during 2006-08. He's been chairperson of the Post-Sachar Evaluation Committee set up by the Ministry of Minority Affairs, and was a visiting professor at the University of Amsterdam Sciences for and Maisons des Sciences de l'Homme in Paris, University of Stan, and University of I'm just not, you know, like the words are not coming to my mouth, was it Berg in Germany. He has worked as director at various institutes in India and is an editorial board of Manpower Journal, Urban India, Journal of Education Planning and Administration, Indian Journal of Labor Economics. He has about 35 books and 300 research articles published in India and abroad to his credit. I think words are just not enough to describe what Professor Kundu is all about. My apology to you, sir. I just couldn't take your questions in our last afternoon session on impact of COVID on women and girls. But I would definitely like to get your questions personally. I would come back to you and get those questions, which would help us in shaping our strategies. So welcome you, sir, in this evening. And also, I would like to request you, we thought of starting with you, if you just could, kind of give us the top development priorities and issues for Odisha as per the ODR reports, that would be really nice.
Thank you. Would you like me to come in right now?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. As I mentioned in the morning, it's really a privilege for me to associate myself with this initiative, and I did a little bit of mine, but much of the work was done by the paper writers, the authors. Largely, they are from the state of Odisha. Many of them are working outside India in national and international organizations. I'm really privileged to have their full cooperation, and much of the credit goes to COISD and particularly Dr. Jagadananda. Let me look at the three issues that Rajesh Bhai had mentioned, and that was the part of the theme of the three sessions. One is this agriculture, natural farming, and the second is the issue of migration, on which I think Rajesh Bhai and myself have put our minds together to raise the issue at the national level. And third is the gender empowerment. And all the three issues have come very importantly in our Orissa Development Report. In fact, I was very happy that I was following the discussion at different sessions. Many of the issues that came up, the questions, the concerns are very much part of the report, and some tentative answers have also been given. One suggestion that was given in the morning, myself and Jagadananda Bhai immediately agreed, a shorter version should come in Odia. This other suggestion was, there are no chapter on conclusion. In fact, we didn't want to be very authoritarian or very definitive. We wanted to raise certain concerns with regard to various sectoral policies that are being followed. And we flagged those issues. But we didn't want to have a one chapter giving the definitive ideas of how the government should move. But at the end of every chapter, the author have identified the tentative directions of solution. I don't want to take much time because it's a very important panel discussion. But let me make the points on the three areas of concern which we have identified as the themes. One is this farming. You know, if you look at the agricultural growth in Odisha, it's very impressive in the last, let's say, 7-8 years. It's not as high as in Madhya Pradesh, but still the growth rate of agriculture, crop production is very respectable. But the question is, how come the rural poverty is not going down at the rate that we expected with a high agricultural growth? In fact, one point that was mentioned by Professor Rajamohan is that the share of agricultural income, GDP, in the state domestic product has gone down despite the high rate of growth of in agriculture. But the dependence on agriculture of the labor force has remained more or less constant. You know, from 58% share in GDP, it has gone down to 27-28%. At the national level, it is even less. But the workforce sectoral diversification has not taken place. And that certainly is an area of concern, and that should have happened. There's a paper on urbanization which shows the rate of growth of urban population has also declined. It was pretty high before 2-3 decades. Number of small towns have not come up. The infrastructural facilities are not available. I have a feeling sectoral diversification is a must. And for that, the rural-urban interlinkages needs to be strengthened. There has to be more non-farm employment generated. This morning, I had to go and join a discussion with the Minister for Agriculture, Mr. Tomar. And one issue that came up, and I would like to really flag it in the context of the natural organic farming. You cannot have massive wheat production going on at the present rate and government buying it, because we are surplus in wheat production. There is not much of extra demand coming within the country or outside the country. It's very difficult to sell the wheat that we have. Our stock has gone up. 40 million tons would be the desirable. We have gone up to 75 million. I think relative pricing is very important, and that's an issue I wanted to flag with the minister today, and I would have written a piece. Basically, the price of rice and organic rice production must go up. If the wheat prices are frozen, I'm talking about the minimum support price, and the rice prices go up there at least by 10 to 15%. Many of the rice production districts are very poor. And I think the relative price has to be fixed properly. And massive stock of wheat, which is rotting and being eaten up by rats in the FCI go downs, that can be tackled. And my analysis of the international pricing tells me that it is possible to sell rice, and particularly the organic rice and superior quality rice, in the neighboring countries and also in European market. So my submission therefore would be that let's give a proper relative price fixation linked with the global market, and I'm quite sure rice prices needs to be should be going up, and that would have a significant impact on the rural poverty in the state of Odisha. Coming to the issue of migration, Rajesh bhai, I wanted to tell you that although Odisha migrants figure prominently in the, you know, in the minds of the Indian psyche, because it was so disturbing to see poor people walking down, taking their luggage on their heads, and the old and children also walking. But if you look at the rate of out-migration to the in-migration, Odisha is much better placed than Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. In Bihar, for every 100 migrant, every 100 in-migrant, there are 670 out-migrants. That means for one in-migrant, there are 7 out-migrants. In Uttar Pradesh, just one in-migrant, 4 out-migrants. Do you know what is the ratio of in-migrants to out-migrants? Out-migrant is 1.5, which means in-migration is pretty large. And if you look at the development in 50s and the 60s, in the 70s, you do find, Rajesh bhai was mentioning, There was migration of the skilled people. Odisha did not have that Rourkela project, and all the major investment that took place in the public sector really brought in a lot of people, and Odisha has been very, very open and liberal in welcoming the migrants. Now, my analysis tells me, and in the last 3-4 months, you find states like Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka have passed legislations and also ordinances saying that, no, we do not want migrants. In fact, I have argued that this is against the spirit of Article 16 in the Constitution. In fact, unless Kerala is the one state which has not gone in for that because they need the labor, I personally believe that migration should be encouraged, but at the same time, Odisha is in a position to invite people and has done that in the past. At the moment, you are right, Rajesh Bhai, that most of the migrants were unskilled, but there is a possibility of skilled laborers going out, and that possibility should not be just destroyed by this kind of a regionalism and the populism that many of the state governments are following. I want to bring in one more point here. Professor Rajamohan did mention, Odisha doesn't have much problem of out-migration in terms of number, basically because the population growth rate in Odisha is not very high. Take any other less developed state, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, with a much higher population growth rate compared to Odisha. Professor Rajamohan was mentioning that is partly because of the high death rate. Yes, it is true. Infant mortality rate, maternal mortality rate is high in Odisha. But I don't think that explains the whole story. TFR, total fertility rate, which has nothing to do with the death rate, in case of Odisha, is much less than the national average. Imagine a state with a low level of urbanization, low level of education, low level of medical facilities, awareness, have a total fertility rate, the number of children born to a woman during her reproductive age is 2.1, which is less than that of the country, an average of the country. Basically, it's because of the tribal culture. Often it is said that, well, tribal population, tribal pockets are big liabilities. I have a feeling that this helps in, first of all, slowing down the growth rate of population. Total fertility rate is less. And I personally believe in the next 2-3, at least, one decade, there has to be out migration from Odisha because this economy may not be able to absorb the people who have returned back. Many of them will go back, but certainly Odisha has a great possibility of sending now a skilled person outside, and that needs to be welcomed. The final point I wanted to mention is about the woman empowerment issue. And you look at the UNDP's analysis, it shows that gender development index for Odisha is pretty bad. It is below average. It's true because if you take woman literacy, woman health status, certainly it's not, as good as many other national average, and some of the less developed states are also doing better in terms of anemia of women and maternal and the child health. But one thing that surprises me, I always thought as I was learning from different papers which I was editing, I was surprised that female-male ratio in Odisha is much higher than the average. The child sex ratio, number of girl children below the age of 6 to the number of boys, are much above the national average, and certainly much above Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh. This is something which is really impressive. How come a state with a low level of education, low level, you can say awareness also, general awareness, modernization is less, but still the female-male ratio in the total population and in the children certainly is commendable, and improvement in the child sex ratio is also commendable. So I see a lot of possibilities. As I mentioned in the morning, there has to be sectoral diversification. Unfortunately, income coming from the industrial sector has declined significantly. whereas at the national level it remains constant.
I'll just make
this point, and this I think is something which must be addressed, that sectoral diversification, urbanization, emergence of small and medium towns, that is the area where Odisha should go forward, and I can see clear possibility of Odisha emerging as a middle level country in the next decade. Thank you. Thank you, Sneha.
Thank you so much, sir. We wanted to hear more and more from you, but I think time is also a constraint.
No, I understand.
Thank you so much, sir. With this, I would like to go to Dr. Bhagwan Prakash, who has been a very eminent person here in Odisha. And sir, you have written a wonderful article about the role of civil society organization in Odisha's development a few days back, I remembered. And keeping that in mind, can I request you to deliberate on this particular issue? How do you see the role of civil society organizations here in Odisha's development? And if you just could, finish your talk within 7-8 minutes, that would be really nice.
Thank you, Sneha, esteemed Dr. Anangapatnam Justice Patnaik, Professor Amitabh, Rajesh Bhai, Rajesh Tandon, Sri Jagadanand and friends. Before I come back to the topic which you have assigned, I would say, professional face of the Odisha civil society. It has too many colors. So in that sense, it's a very colorful civil society in Odisha. I would just make a very passing remark about Professor Amitabh Kundu. That is, I would like to say, I have also mentioned it in the chat box, that Odisha to me appears to be a development paradox. So development paradox in the sense, this is a state which has 11% of the water resources of the country. But irrigation facilities are too poor. This is a state which has the soil is very rich, but the productivity is very low. This is a state which enjoys continuously political stability for the last more than 20 years, which is one of the requirement of development. If you want to bring in development, then there should be stability, peace, political, lack of political disturbances. So this is a very fairly peaceful, politically stable environment. And then about Amitabhji was mentioning about the population planning. And we have been witnessing for last almost more than two decades, a declining of the population of the state. And then a recent trend which has escaped the attention of our experts is now in Odisha, the primary schools and kindergartens are being closed down. This year, the government plans to close down 14,000 schools because there are not many children. So whether it is a link to our education system, the quality education issue, or it has some population dimension. So that is one issue which also civil society of Odisha has to be concerned about, because the government, I have spoken to the government, there is a lack of understanding, proper understanding about the issue. I have seen in Kerala, you have seen how the population, how schools are being closed down. I have seen it in Singapore for the last almost 25 years, quarter century. There are no children, schools are being closed down. So this is one issue. I think civil society is not yet, has not yet studied properly, nor even the government and the educational planners. So that that is one issue which is related to my question about the development paradox. We have everything about the political stability in the morning session. Amitabh was mentioning about the political stability, about leadership, and here is a state which has 31 members of parliament, not a small number. And you might have seen the states having 7 members, 8 members, 5 members in the parliament. They are in a position to better bargain for resources than the state. So the challenge is how it's an agrarian state, but the agriculture contribution of agriculture to the GDP is also very low. It has surplus food, but we don't have many food processing units. We have enough. We are a surplus state in terms of energy, from energy to electricity to electronics. So electronics can produce more jobs than the water and electricity. So this is one aspect which can help the job profile, the employment profile of the state, particularly the young people. And we have 35% of our land is under cultivation, but we have not been able to provide irrigation, needed irrigation facilities, despite we are a water surplus state. We have mining, but mining, we have not been able to convert mining to manufacturing. We are very good at paddy producing, but we are very very inefficient in productivity. So the production to productivity will be a very good jump if we can manage that with proper planning. Then income poverty. We are in income poverty. We also have been not doing very well. But the next challenge is, since the service sector is growing every day, so whether it can be made better if we shift the focus from income poverty to capability poverty, about our health, our education. These are the two sectors which can help in this direction. Odisha is in between the lowest 5 states and the highest 5 states in terms of people under poverty line. So this is the broad situation. So sometimes having all the favorable development parameters, Odisha is still underdeveloped. So that is one question. Only I think Amitabh has the answer. Can I have the answer? So now coming back to civil society. I was telling you how the variety of the organizations here, but before we discuss civil society, I will take you to 2019, when Odisha was struck, mostly coastal Odisha was struck with the Fani. And let me also take all of you to a very, very remote village, Baroda Pada. Baroda Sai, they call it Baroda Sai. Sai is the part of a village is called Sai. So in Baroda Sai, in Nayagarh district, when the Fani struck the coastal Odisha, so and COISD, as usual, always in the first responder. In any disaster situation, COISD has a reputation of being the first responder. And COISD organized people, villagers, women showed interest. You will be happy to know that the many women came, for hundreds of them. They came forward, they said that we are from a hilly region, but we want to help the coastal people affected, but we cannot give you money. We can give you trees. We can give you plants. we can give you seeds. So that was the response of the villagers. And it was surprisingly this, we also, our volunteers and our professionals, they were also surprised to know that many people wanted trees and seeds than money. And when these trees were presented to them, trees and plants, thousands of trees and plants, they came with these plants and trees, and they met the people and donated them. Because there was also a vast destruction of the forest and the trees during the funny. It was an emotional scene. Village women, tribal women, and coming with the head loads of plants and trees, traveling 7 kilometers, 8 kilometers, 10 kilometers to give.
Sir, can you just wrap up within 2-3 minutes?
Hello.
Sir, can you wrap up in 2-3 minutes, please?
I'll take the 2 minutes to wrap up. What I was going to tell you, and the second incident happened in Delhi, where Justice Patnaik was present in that meeting. You know, there was a meeting of various Odisha-based, Delhi-based Odia organizations, and we appealed to them to contribute. And they all contributed, and they said, what are the materials you want most urgent? And then somebody stood up. I had received a report from CISD that actually there is more need for sanitary pads than dry food. So that is very interesting, because sometimes we do not realize what is actually the need. So Odisha Civil Society, made a study. It was the first study, civil society, Odisha Civil Society, which actually first of its kind in this sense, many sectors we touched. We developed an index, and in that index, we divided the whole civil society sector and to the structure of the civil society, what is the breadth and citizen participation, what is the environment of the civil society, in which environment, supportive or restraining environment, how they are working, the political context, basic rights and freedom, what is their role and how they are involved in this, legal environment, state civil society relationship, civil society market relationship, private sector or civil society relationship. That is one. The third one was the values of this. What are the values of the civil society? Tolerance, non-violence, gender equality, poverty eradication, environmental sustainability. So that is one. Third one. The fourth one was the impact of civil society. Here is a state which has more than 30,000 civil society organizations, small and big, they are existing. So what is their contribution, and what is the impact of their presence and their interventions in the state, in how they are influencing public policy, how they are holding the state government and private corporations accountable, how they are responding to social interest, empowering the citizens. So, to conclude, why people, particularly the government, and now the situation in Odisha in terms of civil society is not very good. There are many restraining forces. But despite that, whenever there is a crisis, the government is looking forward to civil society organizations. And why it happens? My own analysis I have given, a number of factors have generated the interest in the civil society organizations. One is many of them work among the poor, among the disadvantaged people and the marginalized. and civil society organizations are, in comparison to government officials, they are more energetic, responsive, creative, flexible, and they operate with speed. The third region is they are closer to the people, to the ground reality, grassroots. They involve and mobilize them for development, the best catalytic agents for change. They are the best catalytic agent for change. They are also low on infrastructure. That is one of the major reasons we found why many, even the government also prefers to collaborate with these civil society organizations. And their cost, their overheads are very less in comparison. The high on output, low on rate. They are non-profit, non-political, mostly value-oriented organizations. Their work is constantly under public scrutiny. That is one very important factor that for them to become accountable. They are optimists, and their work approach is professional and human. And their priority is participation.
Thank you, sir.
Because of these factors, the civil society has immense potential to contribute to the development of a state. Only thing is the state civil society participation. There are many things to. So this is a relationship which is not very optimistic situation, and so that's all. Which
Thank
I wanted
you.
To
do. Thank you so much, sir.
All my colleagues, they are happy to see they are from the civil society. Many of them experts, professionals, and
thank you, sir, for your faith and for your civil society organizations here in Odisha. And with all your advice, I think definitely the volunteering spirit is there, and definitely they would come to your expectation always. Thank you so much for your wonderful deliberation. With this, I would like to go to Justice Anand Kumar Patnaik, sir. I'm sorry for the delay that we have made, and in fact, I'm requesting all the guests and all the participants to bear with us for another 15-20 minutes. Justice Anand Kumar Patnaik is going to give a keynote address to this evening, specifically in the context of Odisha development, collaboration between the government and the civil society organization. Over to you, sir. Sir, kindly unmute yourself. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Ms. Dehaji. First of all, I must say thanks to Sri Jagananda and CSYB for having given me this opportunity, right, for speaking on the subject development priority in Odisha. Role of civil society. Now, first of all, I have heard Dr. Rajesh Tandon, Dr. Amitabh Kundu, Dr. Bhagwan Prakash. Now, they are all very experts, and they spoke very well, a lot of statistics. I don't have that kind of an academic qualification or research on the subject of development. But so happened, I wanted to be a political leader, frankly. I joined the profession, legal profession, very ambitious as a political leader. I thought I'd become one day a minister or chief minister of Odisha, right? And lead the government and development of Odisha, right? But after I joined the profession, I thought I was not fit to be in the business of politics. Unfit, totally. So I remained as a lawyer, became a judge, ultimately in 2014, I retired from the Supreme Court. without being anywhere near politics. But it so happened, after I retired, I was put in charge of development by the Supreme Court as the oversight authority for funds collected from the miners by way of penalties amounting to rupees 16,000 crores for development of tribals and other local population of three districts, mainly Keunjar district, Mayurbhanj district, and Sundargarh district. Under a SPV, which had been created pursuant to my directions in Supreme Court, when I was in the Green Bench, heading Green Bench, which is called the Orissa Mineral Bearing Areas Development Corporation, OMBATC. So it so happened that the special SPV, which was created pursuant to my direction as the Supreme Court, was ultimately put under my charge after my retirement in 2015. And this charge was given to me in 2018. Right, 16,000 crores. And I have been looking after the development, basically drinking water projects for the tribals, education for the tribals, health for the tribals, livelihood for the tribals. And I am going now, three districts, Sundargarh district, Keunjar district, and Mayurbhanj district, and the nearby areas, to see what can be done, what cannot be done. And the projects are now in full force, they are being executed. It is out of this knowledge that I gained the last 2 years that I would venture to speak on the subject of development priorities in Odisha and the role of civil society. I have read the book sent to me by Jagannathanji and on the development of Odisha, right? And he has written an article on perspectives towards sustainable development of Odisha. And in this article, he has identified the development priorities, and correctly so. And some of these development priorities have been discussed today by Dr. Tandon, by Dr. Amitabh Kundu, and Professor Bhavan Prakash. These are health and nutrition. And I found a book written by John Breeze and Dr. Amartya Sen, titled An Uncertain Glory of India and its Contradictions. In this book, they have clearly stated that so far as the health sector is concerned, particularly in rural areas, it has to be by public investment. You can't leave it to the private investment. You can't have private hospitals in rural areas. Similarly, I agree with Dr. Tandon when he said school education has to be private investment. Then public investment, not private investment. It's all like in urban areas, you may have some good schools, right? But school education, in my opinion, I've gone around, I've seen that they have to be public investment. And as a matter of fact, Odisha has got a number of model schools throughout the state. And I've been those in the model schools, and we have been providing funds in these three mining districts, wherever there's lack of hostel, and wherever my girls' hostel, or boys' hostel, or any other facilities, we have been supplementing the funds of the state to provide good education to this tribal population. Livelihood and skill development. Yes, we heard Dr. Amitabh Kundu saying there's a lot of out-migration has to be there for Odisha because there are no factories. There's no industry here. And when I went around, I found Keunjar, a skill development center. They are being taught tailoring. And these young tribal girls and boys, after learning, they were traveling to Chennai for employment. We heard them speaking. They said that we sent so much of money to our parents, tribal parents, and tribal parents said yes. They get so much and they send so much of money to us. What a wonderful experience we found. These are practical situations. Now, rural employment is a big problem. And that is why the migration is taking place. Something has to be done. Manufacturing is out of question in Orissa except mineral-based industry. Because the other states are far ahead and other countries are far ahead. So this Make in India thinking will not apply so far as Orissa is concerned. Orissa will have to be catchable. Only mineral industries can do very well. Or forest-based industries can do very well because the raw material position is there. Farmers' income have to be increased. This is another area. Slum dwellers. Dr. Tandon mentioned about something has to be done for the poor, urban poor. Odisha has passed an act, right? And they are providing facilities to slum dwellers. When they are selling out, they are allotting land. Recently in Cuttack, right, a lot of dwellers were taken out, shops were removed. They were provided land for setting up their own little shops and the houses. Then dealing with natural calamities. This is what Dr. General has mentioned in his article. Natural calamity is a big issue in Odisha. All right, every year, every alternate year, there's either a drought or a cyclone or a flood. These natural calamities have to be taken out. And drinking water is obviously, particularly in the mineral-based areas, is a big problem because you see, drinking water is polluted. It's not pure. They are full of mineral. I've gone down to Keunjar and other districts and I found out that their drinking water has got minerals. They cannot be taken by the local population. If they take it, they'll be very much affected. So drinking water is the problem. These are the priorities. But then, apart from these development priorities mentioned in Sri Jagannath's article, I would like to add four more priorities which civil society may think of. And these are in the context of whatever happening in the country today. One is harmony and spirit of brotherhood transcending religion, caste, regional and sectoral division. They're very important area. Civil society has to work on it. Without peace, without harmony, without brotherhood, without fraternity, no development is possible. I have been a judge in the Northeast for 8 years and so much of fight that is going on. How can anyone concentrate on development work with no peace? Just as in a family also, if there's no peace, no harmony, the family cannot grow, prosper. Same thing applies to the society. Then Dr. Rajesh Tandon rightly pointed out that the industrial agriculture has to be given up. Use of fertilizers have to be given up. More of production and more of income have to be given up. And we have to go in for organic agriculture. And this is taken from the fundamental duties under Article 51, protection and improvement of natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, and wildlife. We have to protect. Odisha has got plenty of it. Then, very important so far as Odisha is concerned, Odisha people are full of superstition, particularly in the rural areas. Witch hunting is also going on. Full of superstition. Under the fundamental duties, there is a duty called development of scientific temper and spirit of inquiry and reform. This is absolutely necessary. Civil society can work on this. And without a scientific temper, scientific understanding of things, no development can take place. But we find all the entire state, you find superstition. It is good to have faith in God. There is no difficulty there. Have religion, but certainly not superstition. And yet another one, which is very important for Orissa, if Orissa has to develop, Gujarat has developed because of that. And the Chief Minister made a Navin Patnaik made a comparison between Gujarat and Orissa and said, in Orissa, there are no entrepreneurs. There are no businessmen. Finance, they have no knowledge, no idea. Right? Unless we have entrepreneurs, develop these entrepreneurial qualities, and this civil society can do. Unless we have these entrepreneurial qualities in our youngsters, there cannot be any private business. They cannot be. They are only looking for a job. And if necessary for a government job, how can the government provide so many jobs? And where are the factories to provide jobs? People must develop that. And you must have seen the, what you call, somebody is telling us, retail sector has developed, service sector developed. Right. Retail sector is all right. Somewhere somebody manufactures, you sell it. Cuttack is full of retail stores. Bhubaneswar is full of retail stores. Beyond that, there's nothing wrong. That is because there's no business sense, no business understanding. Finance, investment, cheap scam. Cheap scam, nothing else. Where to invest, where not to invest. Right? That financial knowledge has been provided. Now, coming to the role of civil societies. See, so far as civil societies are concerned, today they have a very important. My thinking is, our political leaders have their own compulsions. When they come to power, they require resources to contest elections. They are influenced by decisions. Executive decisions are made accordingly. Right. Civil society, which is literate, which understands, must be able to influence those government decisions. Must be able to influence legislation, must be able to influence judicial issues. I may give some examples. You know this, what you call harassment, sexual harassment of women at workplace prevention and redress of grievances Act 2013. Who influenced it? It is Vishakha. Vishakha, it was a civil society which was working only on gender justice. It started permeating into judiciary first. Ultimately, Vishakha judgment came from the Supreme Court, and that is in 1997. Supreme Court 1977 SSC 323. The Supreme Court laid down the Vishakha guidelines until the law was made, and thereafter Parliament passed the Act, the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplaces Prevention Prohibition Redressal Act 2013. Second, who brought in this? Since Jagannath must be knowing, Right to Information Act 2005, Mr. Kejriwal, Mr. Aruna Roy, they worked and pleaded that we must have the Right to Information Act, and ultimately the legislation was passed. Who brought in the Foods Right to, there's a National Food Security Act 2013? You must have heard about Biraj Patnaik, who led the fight for food. Food security. And today we have that act. Today, when I was in Chhattisgarh, I was reading how vigorously he was pleading for right to food. When I was dealing with the judgment. So civil society can play a very important role to influence. And let me tell you, I myself have delivered judgments, two judgments, in mining matters when I was on the green bench. Those two cases were fought by the common cause. Right, led by Mr. Prasad Bhushan. Right, well, go on. And one principle that laid down why was, whoever takes minerals from Goa must contribute 10% sale price, right, to the collector for local population development. Right. And that is how the judgment was given effect to, and it was amended. The MNDR Act was amended in 2015. Every country, Mineral Development Fund was created, 10% sale price, funds came for local development. The second one, the common cause by which Umbetsi funds were created. First order was one mine, right? That got about 800, 900 crores to this Umbetsi, right? And thereafter, second order was this Lokurs, the Supreme Court, that gave me 15,000 crores. It came up to 16,000 crores. Came to this Umbetsi fund, which is now being utilized for tribal areas. The principle is, if you are exploiting the mineral areas of that place and making money, the miners must also contribute to the local development of that place. That's how Umbetsi fund is come. That is how huge development is taking place. I heard Mr. Professor Bhavan, Dr. Bhavan Prakash mentioning, Odisha is what we call a development paradox. Why? Have you thought of it? Everything is there. No money. No funds. I remember I was in sales tax standing council for Odisha with Biju Patnaik, Chief Minister. No funds. And Mr. Biju Patnaik used to make a statement, 96% of the what is government money is going only on salary and overheads of the government. When I came back from Guwahati as judge, Orissa, Mr. Navin Patnaik started complaining, we have no funds. And there was litigation filed before me immediately. Overdraw, they were going on overdraw. And in one case, debt recovery tribunal attached the overdraw account of state government. Result is no salary could be paid. I had to stay that, right? And thereafter, from 2003, the resources started developing. And because the resources started developing, so much development has taken place. 2003 to 2013, you read the book on the economy of Orissa by Dr. Pulin Dayak, Dr. Santosh Panda, and Dr. Prashant Patnaik, which says from 2003 to 2013, they have taken the census and found what huge amount of development that has taken place in terms of poverty reduction, both rural and urban, right? Retail sector, various areas. So without money, nothing is possible. And once the resources are organized, things fall into place, things happen. This is the point I'm making. Now the second role that the civil society can make, they can supplement the role of the authorities or the authorities in natural calamities like funding. Even COVID, migrant workers, they have to be taken care of. This is an important role that civil societies have played. I know Mr. Jagannath's organization, CI Wesley, has played a very important role doing funding. Migrant workers, many civil societies have played an important role, absolutely necessary. Third role is what the CSU are doing, others are doing also, training the future of the youth of the state for service to society besides earning their own income. Unless we have the future generations thinking for doing some good for the society instead of only making money and enjoying, right? We cannot have a good future. Odisha cannot develop. So this is the last, this is a very important area in which civil society can train up our youngsters. And finally, I would like to say, civil society lacks resources. They have to raise the resources. They cannot have the resources on their own. They're not business managers. So they have to develop their credibility. If they develop a credibility and perform, surely there are many people who are prepared to give resources to them. The credibility has to be maintained. If credibility is gone, then no resources will come. This is what I wanted to say. I must thank everybody, and particularly Dr. Tandon, Dr. Kundu, Bhagwan Prakash, Jagananda, for having given me this opportunity to listen to you all, more important, and take some inputs from you all for my work as the oversight authority on MATSI in the three mining districts. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It is really wonderful to listen to you. And also thanks for reminding about several laws that has come into force because of the civil society organization, starting from Visakha or even Right to Information Act and many more. And thank you so much for your deliberation, sir. With this, I just would like to actually go to Mr. Jagdanand, who is actually the person who has conceived this Odisha Development Conclave, the Odisha Development Initiative. For 1 or 2 minutes, if you just would like to come in, Jagdanand bhai.
Okay, thank you, Sneha. Thank you, Justice Patnaik. You know, has really stole this source. I think it was such a fantastic, revelation out of your own experience. But let me quickly tell you two things. One is, you see, in development, there are hardware where you have to lay drinking water, you have to lay toilets, you have to do this, do that. And hardware is very, very important. And government is good at doing hardware. But there is a software component also in development. And software is what? You have to help people in local planning. You have to help people in accessing services. You have to help producer groups to get organized. You have to create the enterprise ability amongst the young people. You have to also help ordinary people to do the market negotiation. And that requires social mobilization. That requires organizing, actually. And in my experience over the last 40 years, I have seen governments can never do this. And if there is one very important thing which came out after the SARC, sir, the Poverty Commission report, if we look at, they identified social mobilization as a very, very key component in development. And that is a civil society domain. And you have very rightly said that, yes, civil society has to not only bring innovations from the ground, but also they make interaction to bring that harmony in the society. Interaction between fragmented communities, between men and women, between Dalit and tribals, between tribal and mainstream population, between religions, that's a very important role and the influencing role, which you said. But at this point of time, I think because resource is a problem and you rightly said so, and now we are getting into legal issues. Now the international source of funding is getting limited. The Societies Act is getting tightened. And I'm part of the Niti Aayog Standing Committee, which is working on a new policy for the voluntary sector. I know what is transpiring there. But at the same time, I think in the tribal areas, especially the 2-3 districts where you are involved, the Umbatsi, the DMF, etc., besides the hardware, the software aspect has to be taken care of. And for software, civil society has to come in a big way. I think there has to be a very good space and a legitimate space for civil society organizations to be part of this new kitty, part of this new fund, so that development can be sustainable and the necessary preparation can be done there with full force, with full vigor, with a purely sustainable character in nature. So thank you, sir, for really coming. Thank you, everyone. I know.
Just a minute before you stop. Thank you for giving this advice. Tomorrow, I am having a meeting of the entire state government with me at 3:30 p.m. over MATSI. I put this session across that civil society has been involved in every area that we are working. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. This Odisha Vikas Conclave was a 3-day affair. This year, doing it in one day, capsuling everything, everybody is not very happy, actually. So including Sneha, who is moderating this. We will come back for a physical meeting. This time when we had the principal secretary tribal in the morning and the director of education in the education session, we were thinking of where are the government of India walas. Niti Aayog, in earlier 2 events, the deputy chairman himself came to Bhubaneswar along with a plethora of officers. This time they are not available. So therefore, we will certainly, you know, articulate the issues which have come up, and through you, sir, to articulate the issues with the state government to the extent possible. I'll give you a note in the morning, sir, to send you the note. What can be done in a very, you know, brisk way, a one pager at least, so that, you know, you can look at it and then advise the government accordingly. But my colleague Sahuji will give a vote of thanks, but I could not check my temptation to show my face to all of you to thank how happy we are as a team to have all of you. Thank you. Over to you, Sahuji.
Thank you so much, Agan bhai. I think it was very much required also for you to come over here. And this is again my privilege to welcome Sri Prafulla Kumar Sahu, who is the co-founder of CYSD and also former chairperson and a very silent worker. Sir, please sum up and then give a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sneha. I extend my respectful greetings to the most eminent and lauded speakers, Honorable Justice Anand Patnaik ji, Dr. Bhagwan Prakash ji, Dr. Rajesh Tandon ji, Dr. Kundu, for your deep insights through your erudite talk. And it has really been inspiring. And CYSD will certainly take note of this and will try to incorporate the great ideas which you have shared with us. Being the co-founder and former chair of CYSD and working in the development sphere for the last 40 years, I would like to just give my few concluding remarks, because it has been elaborately articulated by all the previous speakers and about the role of civil society and the development priorities in Odisha. What I will do here, briefly touch, because I'm known for always giving a short speech, so I'll just touch upon few concrete key ideas. What civil society, especially in Odisha, will be able to do, and also in Indian context. The civil society is a larger fraternity of all of us, for whom we have worked for the last 4 decades relentlessly, with total putting out full endeavors and with total commitment and devotion. Let me just flag 1, 2, 3, 4 very pointed ways. One, civil society, we now call it, let us see about voluntary action, voluntarism, voluntary organizations, NGOs, and civil society organizations, and further take it to the community building organizations, people's organizations, local organizations in the villages, women's organizations, youth organizations, farmer organizations, whatever you name them. So they have a tremendous role to play in the society, and they are going to stay. These are integral part of our society. And they are diverse organizations. Diversity is the charm. So therefore, what is important is, now the civil societies over time immemorial have immensely contributed to the cause of social development, economic development, and development of the state and the country. Whether it is communal harmony, whether it is social harmony, whether it is building of trust building and peace building, and more activities in the livelihood, building disaster resilient communities, building health issues, helping in education program, and working for the welfare of the communities, and especially the sectors which need safety net, the disabilities, orphanage, and the old age, etc. Apart from that, the right-based organizations and working something for the people's participation, social mobilization, community mobilization, which is the key. And I remember with the last 40 years of our work in CYSD, what is our USP, what is our niche? That is social mobilization and community mobilization. Just more than a million of life, more than 1 million lives directly, helping them from poverty towards prosperity. So that is a no mean achievement. And we should be proud, but simultaneously we also think that a lot needs to be done. A long way to eradicate or to diminish the poverty of Odisha. One thing is important here. The civil society alone cannot do much because they have limited resources. What is important is the government has the maximum resources, corporate has the maximum resources, and civil society has the human potential and the ground reality experiences which they have learned by working in the community, staying in the community, staying in the field, working with the tribal people, and then a plethora of experience, which is gigantic. So here, what is important is that, you know, that government, corporate, and civil society, they're the three arms of our society. And if there is a harmony between them, and they work in tandem and together, tremendous amount of development process will be achieved. What's important here, there is some amount of trust deficit between the government and the civil society, between the corporate to little extent, between civil society. So what is important is that how we can minimize the trust deficit and towards trust building and trustworthiness. That is it. And there should be regular interface, dialogue between the government, the corporate, and the civil society towards doing societal good. I know after the CSR enactment and lot of corporates are only limiting to their peripheries and their areas of operation, but not trying to do something as a great holistic operation in the state to help and enable larger cooperation and collaboration in the civil society. So what is important is now collaboration, cooperation, networking, and synergy building, solidarity building, togetherness is the answer to promote social development process. Another one or two points I will highlight upon, because the CSOs, civil society organizations, you call it broadly, they are committed to deepening democracy, working towards inclusive society, and they promote the value of equity and upholding the fundamental rights, upholding the values of constitutions. And we should teach, and not only teach, but we should enable our young people, young generation, youth, the tribal leadership, the young women leadership, which have been harnessing over years. And at least we in our organization, other civil society organizations, we collect, they must have built up thousands of young potential youth leaders, women leaders, not that leaders are political leaders, but they're the social service leaders. So that is a great scope and opportunity for them to contribute large extent to development of the society. Another dimension, what is I highlight and harping on this very, very vehemently, voluntarism, voluntary action, volunteers, they are the integral part of civil society action. They are the people who make things possible. And you know that, what is voluntarism? Shomata coming out of the core of the heart, they want to extend service. What is service? What is seva? Love in action. And volunteers, what are they? They are love in motion. So therefore, the voluntarism and the voluntary action to be propelled. And if you see globally, all over everywhere, the community action, the voluntarism, the people's participation, people's action, if you monetize those will be billions of dollars. Billions of dollars mean touching trillion. And in Indian countries, thousands of crores of rupees. What I highlight here is the voluntarism is the volunteers are not paid. They don't have a price tag because they're priceless. And I would like to quote here the two important quotations. The best way to, from Mahatma Gandhi one, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. The best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in the service of others. Second, by we make a fulfilling life by what we give. Alone we can do little, together so much. Therefore, the voluntarism is to be propelled. Voluntarism is the essence of life. Voluntarism is the essence of civil society action. Voluntarism is the essence of voluntary action and promotion of development process. And volunteers, as I told you, they are not paid. They have no price tag, but that the priceless. And if you imagine the amount, if you monetize, I told how much money in the terms of you quantify, the terms of contribution they make to the society. Life's most persistent quest is, what are you doing for others? Martin Luther King Jr. So here the issue is totally the joy of giving, the joy of sharing, the joy of loving, the joy of caring. That is so vital and important, which reflects, emanates from the issue of, from the heart of the volunteers and the voluntary. So that is so vital. And I would like to only touch upon one or two more points, which is so important to, I feel, the collaboration, the partnership, the togetherness, working together, synergy building is so vital and so important. So that need to be promoted, that need to be harnessed between the government, corporate, civil societies, and even to the larger extent, it should sort of pass the communities, community participation, community building organizations, CBOs. And we have millions of self-help groups and doing groups. They are so activated now, so empowered now. So we have to also catch them and with them in tandem and bring their, harness their potential and leadership, and they will be champion, and their youth would be the champion for the future generation, which our research rightly pointed out. So they are the future. And one or two more points I would just highlight. What is important here is that not only we talk about promotion of developmental work, livelihood, food security, we have tremendous amount of tremendous challenge in the civil societies before them. Food and nutrition security, energy security, and you have to talk about this climate action, climate change, the global warming, what is happening. And we have to also foster, nurture the biodiversity, the preservation of nature, working environment cause, so that we live a healthy planet for the coming generation, the best place to live in and a good place to live in for them. And therefore, we could not be exploiters. So therefore, two things. One is, Mahatma Gandhi rightly told, the earth is enough to meet need, but not for all's greed. Now, coming back to the Thanksgiving, which is a part of my process, so that I would just highlight. One, first of all, we're extremely grateful and profuse thanks and deepest gratitude to all our learned speakers, eminent speakers. I already took their name again, Honorable Justice to Justice Sri Anand Patnaik Ji, Revered Dr. Bhagwan Prakash Ji, respected Dr. Rajesh Tandon Ji, respected Dr. Amitabh Kundu Ji, and all other in the previous sessions. It is a wonderful event. And like Jagdan Ji, my colleague, spoke.